Chinese studios have been making significant strides in AAA single-player game development, with numerous released and upcoming titles, and one of the most promising examples is Wuchang Fallen Feathers from Lindsay. This is a new Souls-like action RPG set in the land of Chu during the Ming Dynasty, and as is often the case with these ambitious projects from smaller studios and from China in particular, this game is using Unreal Engine 5, and thanks to its beautiful art direction, the game looks impressive and offers a wide variety of aesthetics and environments. In terms of performance stability, Wuchang fares better than most other UE5 games. While there are occasional traversal stutters and minor hitching, the game generally maintains smooth frame times with consistent performance. However, leveraging Unreal Engine 5's advanced features like Lumen, Nanite, and Virtual Shadow Maps comes at a cost, not just in terms of performance, but also in VRAM usage. Even at 1440p with DLSS set to quality and textures on low, the game consumes over 8GB of VRAM, and that's bad news for the 3060 Ti, because here with DLSS quality and everything on low, it's already clear that 8GB of VRAM just isn't enough, so making this game run well on the 3060 Ti is going to be challenging. But let's see what we can do to make it work, and let's start with upscaling. The game natively supports DLSS 4 Transformer model with preset K, which at 1440p using balanced mode gives DLSS a big leap over FSR 3 and TSR, delivering a sharper and more stable image. TSR provides a cleaner image than FSR 3, but it tends to look softer in motion. FSR 3 on the other hand suffers from noticeable shimmering and struggles with screen space elements like the small grass shadows. It also introduces visible pixelation and ghosting on fast-moving objects. DLSS isn't flawless either. It shows some disocclusion artifacts, in addition to more boiling and lumen lighting as you can see here. Now the reason TSR looked softer in the early examples is tied to the anti-aliasing setting. As you can see here, using high reduces shimmering significantly but also makes the image noticeably softer, and performance wise there is no significant differences between the options. So for upscaling, if you can't use DLSS, I recommend using TSR over FSR 3. You can increase the sharpness and keep anti-aliasing on high for a more stable and cleaner image, but if the softness bothers you, drop anti-aliasing into medium instead. Moving on to post-processing, this one controls the quality and presence of some effects like sun glare, light shafts, and bloom. And performance-wise, there is roughly a 3% cost when moving from low to medium or high. So if you like these effects, I recommend leaving this one at high. Next we have shadow quality. When it comes to environmental shadows, there is no major visual difference between the options. Even low shadows look good and remain stable. However, self-shadowing is where the difference becomes more noticeable. As you can see here, high and ultra provide more stable and refined self-shadows compared to low and medium. The shadow quality setting also adjusts the draw distance of certain artificial light sources, with high and ultra extending their visibility compared to low and medium. Additionally, there is an extreme option which increases the level of detail used for casting shadows, resulting in more accurate and detailed shadow shapes. Performance-wise, there is approximately a 6% cost when moving from low to ultra and a 10% cost when going to extreme. So for this one, I recommend sticking with low or medium if you have an 8GB GPU. But if VRAM is not a concern, high is a solid choice. Next up is effects quality, which adjusts the quality of certain special effects. Like here, we can see that medium and high display more fire effects compared to low. But the bigger visual impact comes from how low disables screen space reflections entirely, and noticeably alters the appearance of some surfaces like here. Performance-wise, there is around a 4% cost when going from low to medium or high, both in this scene and in more intense effects-heavy moments like this fire scene. So I highly recommend keeping this setting at least at medium. Moving on to viewing distance. This one controls the draw distance of elements that don't use nanite, such as foliage. And as you can see here, high displays more grass at a distance compared to low and medium. Performance-wise, this setting has no significant impact, therefore I recommend keeping viewing distance at high. Next, we have texture quality, which is a crucial setting for the 3060 Ti. As expected, this one controls the quality of the game's textures and anisotropic filtering. So for 8GB GPUs, I recommend keeping this one at low to avoid any VRAM issues, and try forcing 16x anisotropic filtering using a tool like Special K or through the Nvidia control panel. This will improve the texture clarity compared to the default low without significantly impacting VRAM usage or performance. Let's move on to vegetation quality. Unlike in other UE5 games, this setting does not affect vegetation density. Instead, using low disables foliage animation and interaction, making trees and plants appear static, as they no longer sway or respond to characters or wind like they do on medium or high. In terms of performance, this setting is quite demanding. The cost can range from around 15% in a scene like this, up to 19% in others like this one. While the visual difference can be noticeable, it's hard to ignore the significant hit to performance, which is why I recommend keeping this one at low. Moving on to volumetric fog, this setting does not have a major visual impact. Even in fog heavy scenes like this one, it's hard to spot any noticeable difference between low and high. However, it still comes with a performance cost of around 5% when going from low to high. Therefore, I recommend keeping volumetric fog at low. Next, I want to discuss global illumination and reflection quality together, because both settings impact the quality of lumen and the game's indirect lighting. Turning off global illumination disables lumen entirely, which significantly degrades visual quality. Setting it to low enables lumen, and increasing it to medium and high improve things further by adding more elements such as characters to the SDF tracing and slightly enhances indirect shading. However, this applies only when the reflection quality is set to medium or high. If reflection quality is set to low, then regardless of whether global illumination is set to low, medium, or high, lumen runs in a simplified mode, one that lacks proper bounced lighting and most ambient shadowing, as you can see here. It's also worth mentioning that using low reflection quality disables lumen reflections entirely. As for performance, going from off to low global illumination while keeping reflection on low results in about a 9% performance hit, and switching to medium reflection costs around 13%, while moving to medium global illumination results in a 20% cost. Finally, setting global illumination to high increases the cost slightly to around 22%. So overall, I don't recommend turning global illumination off, as it breaks the game's lighting in many scenes. Instead, keep it at low and use low reflections if you need the extra performance. And if you have enough performance to spare, consider switching to medium reflection. Just keep in mind that on some scenes like this one, it can increase the VRAM usage and significantly impacts performance on 8GB GPUs. And last but not least, we have ambient occlusion. This setting controls the quality of SSAO, which helps fill in the gaps left by lumen and adding depth to the game's lighting. Thankfully, it has little to no impact on performance, so I recommend keeping it at high. So given everything we've discussed so far, these are my recommended settings for Wuchang Fallen Feathers. Now let's compare the performance and visuals between the extreme preset and the optimized settings at 1440p using DLSS4 balanced and low textures. And I have chosen this early area to test the optimized settings because it's one of the most demanding spots on both performance and VRAM usage, at least during the early hours of the game. And as you can see, lighting quality takes a noticeable hit when using low reflection, which is why I've included a version of the optimized settings with medium reflections in the comparison. And on average, there is about a 48% performance improvement when going from the extreme preset to the optimized settings with medium reflections, and around a 59% boost when using low reflections instead. Before ending this video, I just want to give a quick shout out to my Patreon. If you're able and would like to directly support my work, consider becoming a patron to get access to the highest possible quality of my latest videos, including this one. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.